your perfection and embraced our rejection.
Oh my God, we'll never fail. Everybody. I love Easter. It's so fun to like see new faces. We had some that drove through the night from Florida, got in at 5:30 this morning to make it to church. So We're thankful that they're here today. And it's everybody just has an extra big smile on their face, I feel like. I don't know. The sun is shining. But most of all, it's a great day to celebrate the risen Savior, the Amen. One that is why we come, right? And why we celebrate and why we have faith today. It's because of Jesus Christ and what happened all those 2,000 some years ago, but today and the way we celebrate it. Let's just pray in the service real quick this morning, and then we'll get started worshiping Him. Dear Heavenly Father, we just are so grateful to be in your house today. We're thankful for every Sunday, but today especially, just to worship you and to praise you for the work that your Son did on Calvary and the victory that he brought to us just because he rose from the grave. So we're praising you today for that empty grave. We're so grateful for all that you do, and because you love us so much, you gave your son for us. And because of that, we can come and worship and stand in your presence. We just love you, and we're grateful, Lord. We're just pray, Lord, that as we sing your praises this morning today and we focus our attention on you today, that your spirit would fall, that we would hear what you have to say, and that we would walk away today because we have praised you today. Lord, we love you, and we ask all these things through your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing this morning?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's just take a minute to greet your neighbor before we start off, go on with the second song.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive.
As a pastor, you get the blessing of introducing people for the first time into the church or transferring into the church. And so we're going to have a few people come forward. If we can have Adam Welms come forward, and Pastor Ken, if he can come forward this morning, and Kim Crone, come forward this morning. Some of you are like, Pastor, that's not Kim Crone. You're right. That is her look-alike sister that's going to accept this on her behalf. And we're going to have at least one other that has taken the membership class but is not here today, but you'll learn more about that in the future. So Becky is standing in for Kim, her sister. Kim has transferred over here her membership from out of state and is living with her mom and helping taking care of her and doing a good job, right, Donna? Amen. She said amen. You see that? She makes headphones even look hip. You see that with the, like, underneath the chin? So you tell Kim, welcome to the Cherry Grove Church of the Nazarene. Next, we have Adam. Now, you may not recognize Adam, but you would recognize his wife, Alexis. There she is, who helps out in so many areas and is like Julie's right-hand lady. So, but Adam has gone through the membership class, which is a very grueling 7 weeks. I mean, you have to stay in the course. But what many of you may not know is he was in the military, so we are grateful for your service, and we want to welcome you into the Cherry Grove Church of the Nazarene as a member.
Right,
yes. Right. All right. And here it is my privilege. This is Pastor Ken, and Pastor Ken and Sheila have been part of the Church of the Nazarene. He's pastored for 20 years on the Eastern Michigan District, but he knew it was time to retire, and he needed to go someplace beautiful. So
he,
that's right. That's right. So let's welcome Pastor Ken. And if we could just do this, because we don't have a whole bunch of time, but we're going to sing I'm So Glad, a part of the family of God. And if we could have our members come forward and just greet them and welcome them into the church, we'd appreciate that. So you guys stand here, and those, come on forward, and let's just welcome them.
So glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this time. For I'm part of the family.
Here. There we go. Now I can hear me. Can you hear me now? Okay. I'm here Tuesday. This coming Tuesday is the first Tuesday of the month, and so we have our Women's Grove. So I'm officially inviting all the ladies, young and old, to come out. It's Tuesday at 6:30. We have an evening in the fellowship hall where we have scripture reading, we have prayer, we have praising the Lord and music, and sometimes we either have a guest speaker or a craft. So if you want to see what we're doing this week, there's a tray with some boot planners out there. And so if you have any old boots, shoes, or tennis shoes, or cowboy boots, and you've got them yourself, and you want to bring your own, bring them with you. We're going to stuff them full of plants and flowers for your porch. So it's kind of a cute thing. So anyway, want to invite all of you to come on Tuesday evening to join us for a time of just getting together and fellowshipping. Okay, so and I would like to ask the Alexis and the little ones to come up forward, if they would, please. I'm going to have a little mini lesson here. And if you just want to kind of sit on the steps on both sides, that would be wonderful. Come on up, kids. I get a sucker. We're going to do a little talking about this week. What is happening this week? What's today? Easter. That's right, Easter. Oh my goodness, that's beautiful. I love it. Tell me some of the fun things. Raise your hand. Some of the fun things that you like about Easter. Elijah.
Easter hunting.
Easter hunting? What do you hunt on Easter?
Eggs for candy.
Full of candy? That's right. What else? Yes.
I do not know.
Oh, okay. You just think about it. We'll maybe come back to you. Jack.
The gift of Christ.
The gift of Christ. You hang on to that thought. We're going to talk a little bit about that. Yes, sir.
He leaves a basket for you.
An Easter basket? What's in your Easter basket?
Stuff.
Stuff. There's nothing better than stuff. I had a little girl said, oh, thank you. I always wanted this, but I didn't know it. Oh, Noah.
The Easter breakfast.
Oh, you like it? We had a good breakfast. Thank you, everyone. It was a wonderful breakfast, yes. So we're going to talk a little bit about Easter, okay? We think about candy and bunnies and little chicks and all those kind of things, but you know, Easter is a wonderful, special time of the year. And it talks about it in the Old Testament. In church, Sunday school, we're studying about the Old Testament and Moses. And we talk about Jesus, and he came. His purpose for coming, boys and girls, was what? Can someone tell me what Jesus' purpose for coming to us was for? He came to earth from God. Okay, let's talk a little bit about, yes, light and life, doesn't he? Yes, he does. In the Old Testament, way back in Adam and Eve's time, they sinned. And so something had to happen to get right with God. So they had to kill an animal and cover their body and take that blood. And that blood, I know we talked about this in Sunday school. During that time in the Old Testament, what did the blood do for us when they sacrificed the lamb? It covered up our sins, didn't it, in the Old Testament? But when Jesus came, he was a perfect Lamb of God, wasn't he? No sin, very perfect. And the last week is called the Passion Week. Jesus was so busy. He came to the triumphal entry on Sunday, and the people bowed down because they were looking for a king for the earth. But Jesus was here for a holy king, a heavenly king, to save us from our sins. In the New Testament, what does Jesus' blood do for us? Washes it away, our sins away. That's right, Noah. As far as what? As far as the east is from the west. And you can't measure that. So God came, and they made a plan to save us from our sin, didn't they? And Jesus was the answer. Jesus came in. The people were looking for a ruler that would save them from the tyranny and the problem that they had in, with the Roman soldiers. But Jesus was here for a mightier cause, to save us from our sins forever and to take us to heaven to be with him. He was victorious over death. He rose Lazarus from the dead, didn't he? And he was raised from the dead on this very Sunday. Easter Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That's proving that we have life after death. We ask Jesus into our heart, ask us to save us from our sin. The Holy Spirit comes in, and we are a child of God. And we need to study and learn about Jesus and God and what he wants in our life, doesn't he? So we can get better and better and better every day. Pray, go to Sunday school, right? And it's fine to celebrate Easter with candy and bunnies. That's a fun thing. But to remember, Jesus came to save us, to take us to heaven with him, to live forever. And what a wonderful God we have. Shall we have a word of prayer? Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your divine intervention in our lives. We are people, human people, and we sin, and you know that. You love us anyway. Help us to accept that into your love, into our hearts. Help us to be more like you every day. Help us to know who you are, that we can apply your love to our lives and be born again and live with you forever and ever in heaven, Jesus. Thank you. And all God's children said, amen. Thank you, boys and girls. And if you come by, I have a little gift for each one of you. So as you go back to your seat, come and see me, and I'll give it to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Patty. One thing I love about Easter is all the beautiful Easter songs that they are, from the hymns all the way to the new songs. And Living Hope is a beautiful song by Phil Wilkins. And I put it all together. Give the words.
Praise the Lord.
lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted high, forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive, forever He is glorified.
Most favorite time of the year as a Christian, the gift of eternal life. We just accept Him into our hearts. He will guide the rest of our lives. It's such calming, peaceful assurance that comes from Him. Revelations 1, it says this: grace and peace be yours from God, who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits in front of His throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the first to be raised from dead, and who is also the ruler of the King of the world. Praise His name. He loves us, and by His sacrificial death, He has freed us from our sins and made us a kingdom of priests to serve His God and Father. To Jesus be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Goes on to say this: look, He is coming on the clouds. Everyone will see Him, including those who pierced Him. All peoples on earth will mourn over Him. So shall it be. I am the first and the last, says the Lord, God Almighty, who is, who was, and who is to come. May God bless the reading of His word this morning. Sing together.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore You. Thank you. golden rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you. Come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Your name is power, breath of living water, such a marvelous mystery. Oh, oh. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Praise the Lord. We're going to go into prayer, but I just want you to realize this. When they came to arrest Jesus, and he said to them, "Who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus." He said with power, "I am he." And they fell back and went to their knees. When he pierces the clouds, every tongue will confess. They will not be able to help it. Now, not everybody accepts Jesus, but they're going to have to declare he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. All because of this day. Lord, we recognize that all of us at one point were in rebellion of you. And yet you have come for us. The very ones who have rebelled against you, that within their own hearts are held captive, and yet you have promised you have come to set the captives free. Lord, my prayer is churches are gathering around the world on this day. Everyone would know that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So, Lord, would you prepare our hearts right now? Whatever it is that we're thinking about, whatever it is that we're preparing for, may we just slow down right now and really lean in to what you want to tell us, or what the Holy Spirit is saying. And, Lord, my prayer is that the answer would be yes. Yes to what you are asking, because you are still performing your mighty works and wonders. Lord, this time is yours, and we are your people, and we pray this In Jesus, the resurrected one, amen and amen. Well, draw your swords and turn to Exodus chapter 17. In ancient warfare, a banner or standard is vital. The banner is what the people rally to. The banner is what kind of differentiates between you and the enemy. When the banner is held high, it boosts morale. But when the banner falls, a defeat has happened, a war has been lost, and morale falls. But a banner is more than just a flag that's held up by someone. The banner represents the kingdom, and it represents the king. And when the banner is held high and it falls, whoever is by, it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter if you're a soldier or if you're an officer, the banner must be raised once again. Because for the banner to be raised high is to declare victory. Today we're going to learn the connection between Resurrected Sunday and the banner. So look with me this morning at Exodus chapter 17. We're going to begin with verse 8. And the Amalekites came, and they attacked the Israelites at Rephidim. Now Moses said to Joshua, I want you to choose some of our men and go out to fight against the Amalekites tomorrow. I will stand on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands. So Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever his hands were lowered, the Amalekites were winning. When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone, they put it under him, and he sat on it. And then Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side, the other on the other, so that his hands remained steady until sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, I want you to write this on a scroll as something to be remembered, and make sure Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Amalek from under heaven. Moses then built an altar, and he called it, The Lord is my banner. Now, this isn't uncommon to ancient warfare. When a nation came in and another nation felt threatened or believed at one point maybe they may become powerful, they want to try to eliminate them. And a young nation, without trained soldiers, has just moved in to the lower part of Sinai, and there's a tribal group, and the tribal group is called the Amalekites, and they have decided they are going to wipe out an entire people group, and so they begin warring upon the Hebrews. Now, this is what we're told in verses 10 through 13, and we're going to read this again here. Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to, now I want you to watch some of these keys here, went to the top of the hill. And as long as Moses held out his hands, the Israelites were winning, but whenever he lowered, the Amalekites were winning. So Moses' hands grew tired. They took a stone, they put it under him. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side, one on the other. Now, I've got a picture of what that looked like, and it would look something like this. Do we have that? Right there. Okay, a man on one side, another man on the other side, holding up the hands of Moses. Now, go to verse 15 for just a second, because I find this a little unique within this story that this would happen. Now, God tells Moses, I want you to write this down. I don't want you to forget what I have done. But Moses does more than that. because it says Moses built an altar. Now, the Hebrew name here, and in some of your Bibles you might have it, is Jehovah Nissi. And it means the Lord is my banner. Don't you find that a little odd that Moses would write that down? I think two things. I think Moses, inspired, begins to speak prophetically. He realized that this battle is bigger than just the Israelites against the Amalekites. It was God's chosen being attacked by the enemy. And God brought the victory through Moses because he had him standing tall like a flag. That's the exact words that is meant there. The Lord is my banner. Now, I want you to hold on to that for just a moment. Because 700 to 800 years goes by, and another prophet is speaking about this very thing. And that is in Isaiah. Let's go there. Isaiah chapter 11. Now, before I read this, Isaiah should sound familiar to you. Every Advent, we read this. Something that's like two chapters ahead, I think in chapter 9. And he will be a branch, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, King of Kings. Does that sound familiar? Every Christmas, we sing that. What we don't know or forget about sometimes is two chapters later, right here, he talks more about who that Messiah is going to be. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, and from his roots a branch, and you see that's capitalized, that's important, will bear fruit, which, by the way, is part of the mandate, the original mandate that God has given on mankind to multiply, become numerous, and bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of the counsel of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decision for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteousness will be his belt, faithfulness the sash around his waist. And then verse 10. And that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the people, and the nations will rally around him. I want you to realize the prophetic message that Isaiah is speaking about. Isaiah knows the message in Exodus about Moses. And when he says the root of Jesse, Jesse is King David's dad. He's referring to, it's going to come from the line of David, right? That he will be a king, and he will be like a banner and will be victorious. Now, when Isaiah is prophetically speaking about this, he's referring to Moses. So people reading this knows, what did Moses do? Moses had a person on his left, he had a person on his right, holding up his arms, and as long as his arms were extended up on the hill, like a banner, which is what Moses said, Jehovah Nissi, he was victorious. And what he's saying is, the root of Jesse will be victorious because he will stand tall like the banner of Moses. Some of you are starting to get it. Now, go to Luke chapter 23. And this is what Luke says. Then there were two men, both criminals. They were also led out with him to be executed. And when they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him along with the criminals. And yes, there was one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And the people stood watching. The rulers even sneered at him, and they said, "They saved others. He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." And the soldiers also came up, and they mocked him, and they offered him wine and vinegar and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." But there was a written notice above him, which was read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself, save us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God, since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you'll be with me in paradise." Remember, as the memorial, Moses called the place of battle of the Amalekites Jehovah Nissi. And what I want you to do is I want you to look at this picture, because remember, there was a man on his left and a man on his right, and his hands were extended up. And he was called that place, "The Lord is my banner, Jehovah Nissi." Isaiah prophesied, "The king is coming, and he will be just like Moses. He will be called the banner, who will be lifted up high on a hill, arms extended, and there'll be a man on his left and a man on his right." And he will declare that he is Jehovah Nissi. About a month ago, I was at a pastoral conference, and I got to meet Evan. I think you pronounce his last name, Awadadidi, but he's from Zimbabwe. He is a pastor of a church of about 35 people. At the time, he said he had two little kids. He had another kid on the way. He was telling us about 2016. 2016, the country was led by a president in name only, but was a dictator. "Don't speak against the government or its leader, or you'd be punished, disciplined, disappear, or killed." He said, "I came to the end of my rope because that day I had to try to figure out how I was going to buy bread for my family." And so he said he had his Bible in front of him, and he grabbed his phone, and he saw his national flag, which the country he loves, when he saw it falling apart with all the corruption, and he put it around his neck, and he began to lament, but he did it on Facebook. And then he showed us that video that he posted, and here's that video.
"The day that I recorded that video, I was really angry. I had literally spent the day trying to figure out how to pay for some very basic things that my family needed, and that included food."
With Zimbabwe in meltdown and its economy in freefall, the veteran president, Robert Mugabe, attended the state opening of parliament last month.
"As a people, Zimbabweans, we were scared. I'm sitting in my office. I see the Zimbabwean flag. The thought that came to me actually was, this flag is a lie.
This flag, this beautiful flag."
And so I take my phone and I propped it up against my Bible. I just start to speak from my heart.
"They tell me that the black is for the majority, people like me.
And yet for some reason I don't feel like I am a part of it. Quit standing on the sidelines and watching this flag fly. Every day that it flies is begging for you to get involved, is begging for you to say something, is begging for you to cry out and to say why.
He said he only had like 100 followers on his Facebook. But the next day, he got a phone call from his dad. And his dad said, "What are you doing?" And he said, and he had some sort of Zimbabwean name for dad. I don't remember what it was. He said, "Dad, what? I'm just speaking what's on my heart." And his dad says, "Don't you realize they will kill you?" And then his dad proceeded to tell him all these men he grew up with who spoke against the government who disappeared. And as he is talking to us, he said, then I started kind of getting scared and thinking, well, who saw this? I only got like 100 people. And he got on his Facebook account and he saw there was a 250,000 people who had already watched it and was replying. And his first response after that was, what have I done? Because he's got two little kids, one on the way. And he knew that even of a church of 35 people, for that many people to respond, that he probably was a dead man. But he said, all of a sudden, something began welling up inside of him. And he knew God was calling him to stand tall like a flag or a banner. And he makes another Facebook pronouncement, and he says the government must know this is not right. So tomorrow, nobody do anything. Don't go to work. Don't go to the streets. Don't buy groceries. They must know that we won't tolerate this anymore. And then this is what happened.
And in that moment, you realize that you don't want it. You don't want to die. You want to live. You want to be part of the victory. You want to see what it looks like when we get a breakthrough. You want to stand on top of the mountain and enjoy the view with everybody. But you also realize that sometimes walking a journey like this means that you have to be okay with not seeing that.
Wednesday, the 6th of July, 2016, we are shutting Zimbabwe down.
Get off the roads and stay home.
Nobody goes to work on that day.
We want them to know that we are serious. Wherever you are, no violence. It's our day. We are all Zimbabweans. Talk to you again soon.
Pastor Evan Mawarire called on Zimbabweans to stay at home in protest against the country's economic troubles.
Someone put up something that said there's no one. I mean, the central business district, and there's no one. And we're thinking, oh my goodness, this is working.
Civil servants held a stay-at-home protest that shut down most businesses, government offices, schools, and hospitals for a day. It was the biggest act of public defiance against Robert Mugabe in a decade.
We have a completely, completely shut down city.
The whole thing came to a complete standstill. And I'm thinking to myself, oh my God. They did it.
And what he realized, 9 million people did not go to work. 9 million. It eventually would cause the current president there at that time to step down. But it wasn't without a cost. His wife was threatened, his little children were threatened, and he saw a warrant for his arrest, and he realized he had to turn himself in. And I wish I could communicate with you the rawness that he was telling us his story. Because as he is speaking to me, the tears are coming down. And he said, I can't tell you all the things that they did to me and how they tortured me. He said, I was leaning up against the wall. My head was between my knees. I was defeated. I knew I probably would die there in that place with the tall walls all surrounding. You can't even see outside. He said, then I saw four men making their way toward me with purpose. And I said to myself, this is it. The guards have talked to these prisoners and they're going to take care of me. And then he said he started crying out to God, Lord, why? Where is the victory? And his head is down and the tears are flowing. And then one of the men who apparently was the spokesperson said, are you Pastor Evan? And I said, I did not reply. And they repeated, are you Pastor Evan? I said, I knew they weren't going away, so reluctantly I said, yes. And the main man that was there to kind of represent the group said, good, we are glad, because we were praying you'd come to our prison so you can teach us about Jesus. He said, I was still kind of confused of what was going on and my head was down, but I could hear the guy talking to me, and he said, Pastor, God has told me that if you will trust him, that one day you will be freer than those on the other side of the wall who think they are free. His head was still down between his knees, still feeling defeated. When finally, with some sort of authority, the man said, Pastor, I cannot leave you in this position anymore, for God has won the victory. Why? Because Jesus is Jehovah Nissi. He is the banner. As Moses' arms were outstretched, it forecasted an event in history that would change everything. And as the prophet Isaiah prophesied, the root of Jesse will be lifted up like a banner, but he will bring victory. And through a flag, a pastor was reminded that one became a flag so that everyone who calls on him can walk in victory. You see, Jesus died not just to save us. He died so we can be victorious. We're going to ask the service to come forward and the instrumentalist to come forward. But I want you to think about this. Because maybe today you want to know this Jesus. Maybe today you believe in Jesus, but your head has been down, leaning up against the wall, and you felt defeated, but you're ready to take the next step. And as that man said to Jesus, I believe Jesus is saying it to you now, I cannot allow you to remain in this posture anymore, because I am Jehovah Nissi, and I have won the victory. Would you stand? We're going to take communion here in just a minute. This is for everyone who has accepted Jesus. And maybe today you want to do that. So I'm just going to ask if you would bow your heads, and we're going to have a time of prayer. And as you are reflecting, maybe this is your prayer today. Today, if you want to accept Jesus, would you raise your hand and I'm going to pray for you. Or maybe today you believe in Jesus, but you have been walking in defeat, but no more. You do not want to leave today without knowing the victory of Jesus. If that is you, would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you. Today is your day. Don't let the enemy tell any more lies to you. Yeah, Jesus, he rose from the dead, but the victory was when he was the banner. Lord, this morning, as we are here in this time and in this space, for those that have lifted their hands today, I want you to pray. And your prayer can be very simple. Lord, I recognize I need you. That I need your forgiveness because of my transgressions. Forgive me and come into my life and help me to walk this life you have called me to live. And for those out who want to take that next step and live in victory, Lord, I have walked defeated for too long. Whether that was because of other people and what they have said to me, whether it's the own voices in my head, or whether that was the enemy, today that stops. Today the only voice that counts is Jesus. And Jesus says that he has won the battle. I will walk out these doors with my head held high, because my King has won the war. At this time, I'm going to ask you to come forward. If you are a believer in Christ, and grab the elements and then take them back to your seat. We'll have this section over here, and if you're in the center section, come here, and if you're over here, come to this. So come forward now and receive the elements, but hold on to them. On that day that Jesus had the disciples together in the upper room, I almost wonder if some of them almost felt a sense of defeat. And yet what they saw as defeat was really victory. Because his body had to be broken to pay the price for your freedom. So take this and remember what was done for you. In the same way, he took the cup and they passed it around, something they had done many times before, but not like this. Jesus declared, "Now my blood is going to be spilt just like the lamb, because I am the lamb." But I will spill it for you. The world will heap insults. The enemy will curse. But he doesn't know. 3 days later, I'm coming back. Take this and remember that he came back. Lord, this day is a day of victory. We are celebrating what you have done. And now we are declaring, today is victory. And we pray this in the one who did it all, Jesus. Amen. He is risen.